You are now tuned into Check This Out News. We connect the streets.
My name is Les Borsay. I'm a partner in Wavemaker Genesis and started my career in the music business a long time ago.
By working at different
concert companies, working at MCA Universal. I manage an artist named Jason Mraz. I currently manage an artist named Winona Judd, and that has nothing to do with cryptocurrency. In 2013, I became an advisor to Ripple. I have a really schizophrenic career, actually. I additionally did the Ethereum pre-sale in 2014, and now kind of focused my efforts working with the Wavemaker Genesis guys. We have a really great panel, so what I'm going to do is let each of the panelists introduce themselves right now, because it's a super diverse panel, and everyone does something a little bit different in entertainment. So why don't we start with you?
My name is Frank Banks. I'm the founder and CEO of Zen. We're building a decentralized platform, surprise, for emerging pop culture video editors, Generation Z, making them stakeholders by allowing them to earn our Zen coin cryptocurrency.
Very good. Very smart.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ann Greenberg. I'm the founder and CEO of Entertainment AI, which is a decentralized smart content marketplace. And I like to say that blockchain is evolutionary, not revolutionary, because the antecedents of this are really, really interesting to take a look at, especially outside of fintech. So I founded a company called Gracenote in the late 90s, based on some IP we had developed earlier in the 90s. And it was really a very early example of what you can do with a decentralized approach. I was the first crowdsource company. I'm really pleased to be here.
Hey, guys. I'm Andrew. I'm a venture partner at Science Inc. We did a security token back in August. I'm also an advisor and mentor at Stanford University StartX Incubator. So I work with a bunch of ICOs. The entertainment ones that I'm focusing on now is one in particular called Kind Heaven, which is an immersive entertainment facility across from Caesars in Vegas, and I'm looking forward to talking about that.
My name is Matt Sorum. I'm a musician. I was in bands Guns N' Roses, The Cult, and Grammy Award winning band Velvet Revolver. And been in the tech space for about the last 4 years. I'm involved with a company called Artbit. My title is Head of Communication, so I'm here to communicate with you today.
The super genius of all time.
And Artbit is a platform built on Hedera Hashgraph. And the space will be for artists, brands, and the community to all share the space and be able to monetize with cryptocurrency. So I'm here to talk about that today, and thanks for having me.
Hi, my name is Lauren Seelig. I'm an investor and advisor to a number of different cryptocurrency companies, but I'm a producer at heart of movies. So I thought I would merge the two things that I love to do, and I'm working with a company called MovieCoin to help make the movie industry more accessible and transparent.
Okay, so in the spirit of merging, I've been fortunate enough to be on a panel with a few of these people. So I'm going to kind of start with this general concept of businesses merging and really thinking about how legacy businesses exist and, you know, the kind of advent of new technologies and how those concepts can exist moving forward. I want to start with you, Matt, because you talk a lot about the legacy business versus, you know, blockchain. And how do you see that working out in the future?
Well, the interesting thing about the blockchain and the data is how artists can get paid. And as we know, I still receive my checks biannually, right? So I have to wait for the administrative factors of all the payments that go through the chain of command. The publisher, the label, and someone's making interest on my money in a bank account somewhere.
Now that's
right?
Fucked up.
So the idea of the blockchain, especially in the publishing realm, and everyone getting paid instantly, fascinates me. And I think that it will come with emerging artists. Like, the legacy artists are there, right? And I think publishing houses have a job that they don't want to give up.
Shots fired!
But I have heard and know that they are looking at these blockchain elements to be able to expedite a lot of the expenditures, right? So I really like that. And for emerging artists, that's where ArtBit comes in. And for instance, little Hank Williams, the yodeler. Now, the new model of record business is grab onto a moving train. So they found this kid on YouTube and they signed him. But he had already built his community. He didn't need them, really. So if he had another platform to be able to monetize himself instantly, he could have done that. But through the YouTube platform, somebody else is making all the money.
Horrible people. Horrible human beings.
With the ads and the brands that are affiliated with YouTube, they've already paid them once, and now they're going to pay them twice. If you don't want to watch the Hank Williams commercial that's across YouTube, you can click off right away. And if you're not a sponsored artist, nobody gets paid.
Nobody.
The brands don't get what they need.
Really?
And the artist doesn't get paid.
Whack!
So that's where ArtBit comes in. And the way that will work will be the augmented reality branding, product placement, if you will, all built on smart contracts, and everyone getting paid through cryptocurrency.
Okay, so that's a natural use case. You know, the blockchain, you know, helping alleviate costs through payments, but also kind of really offering transparency. So is transparency a good thing, and is that something that's going to be accepted in existing businesses today, where content creators, you know, are not always the most forthcoming with payments? And anyone can answer this.
You got to remember that the record companies were offered when music was digitized. They were offered that.
I was not aware of that.
Streaming aspect of music, right? With the original digital version of that, it ended up being Apple and iTunes and everything. And they naysayed it. So it's the same thing that's happening now. I really feel this is no different than digitized music. And it will come. It just will take time. And artists have to be the ones that speak out on what they really want. But I feel that the old guard is always going to be there, and they're going to try to keep that command. But much like, you know, everything that's happened with Airbnb and Uber and all the other direct source stuff, music is no different. We just need to build the new community and the emerging new young artists. Because, as we know, older artists will be in the catalog, but they're going, you know, to get older and older and older. So we can build the new world.
Payments are part of it.
Payments are part of it. I just think it's sort of like what Matt was saying. It's really about now who gets to participate in the fundamental aspects of the business model, where, you know, the music and the way the music industry was structured beforehand, it was basically like this input that the record companies tried to get cheaply as possible.
The worst trade deal maybe ever.
So now you just have a different way that you can organize things, where the people who are actually creating the value can participate in that to a greater degree. And that's really what it's all about. I mean, it's really about using that technology to enable that, at least from my perspective.
Yeah, and I think influencers even have a problem with monetizing their following today. Because if you ask anyone like Jake Paul or whoever, most of their revenue is coming from merchandise, which is a sign that YouTube and other content channels aren't giving them the benefit of higher revenue off of view count or driving their community to YouTube, which is a third-party platform. So to side with Matt, it'd be better if they could monetize their content via the blockchain and not have to deal with that content provider that's taking a massive cut. And then they wouldn't be depending on selling merchandise, which changes content, which changes what kids are watching, and kind of leads influencers down the road of creating content driven by clickbait as opposed to content that could actually be watchable.
We want to remind you to please like our Facebook page if you haven't already. When you join, you'll be able to receive weekly updated news and events, live video messages, and most importantly, you'll be able to interact with tons of people just like you. So go on that button on top of your Facebook page and give it a click. or interact with us on Instagram. Without each and every one of you, Tech This Out would not exist. We couldn't do it without you. Make sure to repost and share different things you see on our page. The more you share, the better. Be sure to watch previous shows on our YouTube channel, and please subscribe so that you can be notified when we post new content. We really want to connect and hear from you, so please don't hesitate to message us. And to find us online, please go to Tech This Out America on Facebook, Tech This Out on YouTube, Twitter, and all social media platforms. Get whole scope at techthisoutnews.com. We connect the streets.
There are significant pain points for influencers and artists. There's also the same kind of pain points for investors, and that certainly exists in the movie business, where I think the first movie I became involved in 2013, by 2014, I still had no idea where my money went. There were these, you know, cam account agreements that I had to basically beg the studio to have access to see where the dollars went and the water flow, and there was zero transparency as to how, when, or if I was going to actually see any of my investment back. And it was kind of an embarrassing situation that you would have thought after many, many years of movie making would have, you know, someone would have solved it, but they haven't. And then there's the whole issue of a lot of people would love to be able to invest in a movie, but they have no idea how to have access to a director or an artist or a script. So this sort of opens up those pain point doors and allows all of those issues to be solved in a very different way, which, you know, the goal is to have that help both investors on the, you know, accessibility and transparency side and liquidity side, and also same thing with the artists. So we're all looking at the same waterfall. We're all looking at the same information. There's no hidden features involved in what we're trying to do, and hopefully that will become the norm. That'd be the goal.
So I want to pick up on what you're all saying, actually, which is we have a continuum from legacy artists to emerging artists and the people we used to call our audience, who are the influencers. And I really stand with the audience and say and I may piss off some people on the panel, but I say the audience is the artist. And that what we're really seeing right now is this massive shift in what can be created. I don't want to just get what we created over the last 100 years of recorded media onto a blockchain, and even if that's the first wave, but I'm really, really interested in seeing what kinds of new kinds of meanings and experiences can be created in ways never imagined before. I think Frank, you're starting to, you know, get in there with this having a flattened marketplace where people are participating, and that's really where I'm focused right now with Entertainment AI, which is to do a flattened marketplace for the automated content, automated smart content creation. And what we're doing is, and I started working on this before blockchain, before Satoshi published his white paper, but was trying to work on the next level of entertainment data granularity. I had Gracenote is the largest entertainment data company in the world, so after I left, I started working on sort of the next level to virtualize production. And so what I came up with was micro metadata. Micro metadata will allow us to go beyond information about information to information about who, what, when, where, and how. So we could completely virtualize it. And because it's an exponential media machine outputting exponential media, I had a problem. I thought, no one's going to fund me. This is before we had Elastic Storage. Because we would be outputting so much media that it would cost more to store it than we could make in the company. So I described it working with a decentralized system. That's why I was really, really early, but described the system to someone about 6 years ago, and they said, have you heard of blockchain? And I said, no.
Anne has an incredible story, and she will share it with everyone after. It's very long, but it's very interesting. And I say that with love,
well,
Anne.
I
want you to spend time.
But I think it's important
time
to think about the meaning that of what we're doing, what this stuff represents.
Right. No, I mean, that wasn't meant to be insulting. So, you know, kind of along those same lines, you know, one of the things that fascinates me is you know, kind of to Anne's point, Anne has been building kind of this disruptive technology, and that was really the spirit of it, and that's where the early kind of investments went. You know, now what we're seeing is more established companies creating a pivot. And they're the ones getting funded. There's underlying businesses. There's a whole bunch of different kind of financial models connected to it. I would say, you know, Lauren, with what you're involved in,
that's a disruptive mechanism. But, you know, just to pick on Kind Heaven for a minute,